question.
So you just recently came back from the T20 Women's T20 World Cup. How was your experience, and can you talk a little bit about that?
It was, I mean, I might describe it as a tournament of destiny, because right from when I got there from a couple of weeks before the actual start of the tournament for the tri-series that India was playing before that with Australia and England. And the first week or so was a little quiet in terms of World Cup build-up. I didn't really get a sense that something huge is about to happen. But once the World Cup actually started, once the warm-up matches were over, the amount of coverage that was there, the amount of marketing that had been done in 2 years leading up to this event, the amount of planning that had gone into extending the season and making sure people are engaged, because in Australia normally the season is over by February, and the tournament actually started mid-February, end of February, and went on till 8th of March. The fact that 8th of March was Women's Day and they had that crazy ambition to fill the MCG. As the tournament went on, especially after the first match where India won and Australia were always on the brink of going out, that momentum really built. You could feel that the entire country was getting involved in that. It helped, of course, that that was pretty much the only cricket that Australia were playing at the time. So just so many things coming together, and at the end, those crazy, I mean, the very fortunate rain window that Australia got in that semi-final, which allowed them to finish things off, was one of the reasons why I really felt that the destiny of that tournament was essentially to change how women's sporting events are looked at, especially women's cricket events are looked at for the next 10 years. I mean, everyone is now going to plan a women's event with much more ambition and much more hope and a much bigger scale, that this tournament has allowed us to dream about that.
Yeah. So one of the most, I think, crowd's favorite teams were Thailand. And we've never seen a Thailand men's cricket team make to such heights. Do you think women's cricket can take a different trajectory as opposed to men's cricket?
Definitely. I mean, for countries like Thailand, USA, China, who are quite serious about getting their teams to the top level of international cricket, which is the top like 10-15 teams, women's teams are a much better vehicle than men's teams. And I think now these organizations are recognizing that, purely because there's a little less competition in women's cricket. Beyond the top 8 countries, there aren't a lot of countries which are very strong in women's cricket. So those last 2 slots at a World Cup, and if it expands more, last 4 slots are always up for grabs. Whereas in men's cricket, I mean, the first 15 slots are so highly contested, and then afterwards an upcoming country can make a claim for to get into a world event. So I think these boards, these countries are recognizing that the women's programs offer them an opportunity to get they're faster as compared to their men's programs. And I mean, not just Thailand, even other countries should be looking at this as an opportunity. If they have an ambition for their team to win a World Cup, then they should probably invest more in their women's teams, because it's more likely that a women's team will win a World Cup before a men's team.
Do you think if cricket goes into Olympics, that would give it a push?
Tremendous, tremendous. I mean, there is absolutely no reason why cricket should not be in the Olympics already. But if by 2028 in Los Angeles, we don't see cricket in the Olympics, it will be very disappointing. There is a good start with Birmingham 2022, where cricket is going to be featured. Of course, all things, if they go to plan, considering COVID and everything that has just gone off schedule right now. But 2022 will be a good start. I think India have missed an opportunity with cricket played at the Asian Games, etc. So those are the kind of places where I would have loved to see Indian men's and women's teams sent both. But it will be tremendous, because, for example, in Thailand got government funding for their cricket program when they were about to go for South Asian Games, or was it Southeast Asian Games, one of the two, I'm not sure. But because cricket was recognized as a sport under those games, the government gives them funding, and the Thailand women's team was full-time for that period of time. So it's that kind of impetus which comes from government funding also, which other countries need much more than, say, the BCCI or Cricket Australia.
Did you see any Pakistan games during the World Cup?
Unfortunately not. I was in Brisbane where they were scheduled to play a couple of warm-up games, but those were washed out.
So generally, there are in women's team, there are the top three, England, Australia and India, and there's a bunch of other teams with, including Pakistan. How much of a gap do you think there is between these teams, and do you see any chances of the other teams making up that gap?
I think the example of South Africa is a great example of how, despite not having a head start, these teams can make up that gap. Now you have to understand that the top three teams have that advantage because they've been playing organized women's cricket since the 1970s and they've been playing it almost consistently. Whereas I'd say in Pakistan, it is the late 90s and early 2000s when the women's program and really started developing and consistently there was women's cricket played. Similarly for South Africa, but South Africa's pace of progress has been much higher. Purely, I think, because one is that their board is really focused on the women's team. Two is that they got sponsorship pretty early and therefore they were able to make the team professionals much more. And three is a little bit of the culture, that there is a fairly strong sporting culture there. So if countries like Pakistan want to improve their women's programs, I think South Africa are a great example of what they've done with their women's programs. Despite starting around the same time, now South Africa are like serious semi-final contenders every tournament. And that's not something we see very often in just a space of 20 years.
You played cricket for India for about 11-12 years ago. How much of an improvement do you see overall in women's cricket in these past 10-11 years?
There are still some players playing who I used to play with and against. Of course, I grew up wanting to share the new ball with Julan Goswami. I've retired, but she's still going on strong. Mithali Raj is another example. But what I've seen change is there is always a couple of players in every team who are world class, and then everyone else who's there and thereabouts. Whereas now that number of players who are world class is increasing. So in the Indian team itself, you have the likes of Mithali and Julan are still there. Harman and Smriti are world beaters. You have youngsters like Jemima and Shefali coming up. So the generational change means that the younger players who come into the team are more ready for international cricket. And that's the biggest difference that I've seen, is that when I was playing international cricket and domestic cricket ka jo gap tha, it was quite a big gap and players coming into the team would struggle to bridge that gap. But now players coming into the team are ready for international cricket a lot more than they used to be when I was playing 10 years ago.
I was watching your YouTube channel. You reviewed the Australian cricket, the documentary that has come out, The Ashes. The feeling I got from the documentary, and I think you also talked about it, that it was very much focused on Justin Langer. As opposed to if we see the Indian cricket team right now, it's very much Virat Kohli's team. So, what is your personal cricket philosophy? A team should be run led by the captain or the coach. There is two different school of thought.
Yeah, I think Joy Bhattacharya in one of the podcasts that he did put this very well. I think that it was on captaincy, is that sometimes a team forms around a captain and sometimes you have to build a team around a captain, and that is again two different styles based on what the captaincy is. I think the examples he was giving is that MS Dhoni at CSK, where you have, because he has this calm presence and the entire management as well as the kind of players they have picked have been gone about in a very calm, organized manner. So that is a team in his image, so to speak, which is just passively developed. I don't think he actively said, because this person is this kind of player, I want that. It's just naturally attracting those kind of players because of your philosophy. And Virat Kohli, I suppose it's the same thing. there's a saying, right? Your vibe attracts your tribe. So if you have that vibe as the leader of the team, you will attract players and be attracted to players who can, who you connect with and who you believe can play the team. So I think in India, it's very much going to be a case, and probably in the subcontinent, of that one central figure in the team, most likely the captain, who will build a team which fits their vision, and therefore it is going to be more or less in their image, you might say, and not necessarily, you can say, spitting image, because Virat Kohli and Ajinkya Rahane are completely different personalities, but Virat Kohli backs Ajinkya Rahane because he sees that fighting spirit in him on the field, even though he doesn't express it with his words or with his body language. So it's that fighting spirit that captains look for in these players. And in a country where India, where you have so many options, so many players who are up to that quality, you can essentially pick and choose the ones who you think have those qualities.
You mentioned MS Dhoni, that's the million-dollar question right now, is will he be coming back in Pakistan? And let me tell you, he's probably the most beloved cricketer outside of non-Pakistani cricketer. So do you think you'll see him in India colours again?
I don't know. This is a lot of uncertainty. I'm sure the plan was for him to be in the IPL, and if he had a good IPL, there was every chance that he just might make a comeback. But now, considering that plan is completely gone haywire because of COVID, we don't even know if the T20 World Cup will happen. So the honest answer is I don't know. And
you like to see him back?
Would I like to see him back? Of course. I mean, everyone who has been a fan of MS Dhoni would like to see him back. He brings quality to the team, which is sometimes indescribable in terms of just the amount of experience that he has. And it's now a proven case study at CSK that experience does count in T20 cricket. And of course, there is a school of thought where you can blur that experience also by giving other players an opportunity. Would I like to see him back? Yes, but I would definitely would have wanted that he had a great IPL and made a very strong case for his return, because for a player of his stature, it would not be nice, as someone who's got a lot of respect for him, to have questions about his place in the team if he does come back into the team.
I think it's becoming a little bit of a selection paradox. They have now gone to KL Rahul instead of Punt. How do you see that? Is it a long-term solution or is it a short-term, like Rahul Dravid did it for a few years for India?
So my philosophy on this is that you can do it as a long-term solution even leading up to the T20 World Cup, but then you have to pick your formats. So a keeper is a specialist job in the sense it requires very different physical skills as opposed to what a batter and a fielder does. So in order to allow Rahul to get into that role of keeper, I don't think then he should be keeping in ODI cricket. I think in ODI cricket, building up to the 2023 World Cup, you should have your long-term plan of who you want your keeper to be there. And if it is Rahul, then 2 years between 2022 and 23, you can maybe experiment with Rahul. But right now, I think Pant should keep in ODI cricket. Rahul should keep in T20 cricket because he does add a lot more balance to the side, and India need that sixth bowler. But considering that the ODI World Cup is a couple of years away, I think Pant should be keeping there. Rahul should not be keeping in both formats because of physical toll that's going to take. I don't want it to affect his batting.
All right. Thank you very much for your time.
No problems.
Thank you.